This is a very interesting topic. You may be knowing it is a very interdisciplinary sort of field. So it is not only antenna, it is more than antenna. And you will come to know the intricacies of this one in during the talk. And on behalf of the APMTT chapter and chair, Dr. Senthil Kumar, I welcome all the participants and welcome the speakers and the other panelists for this talk. And I'd like to place on record my sincere thanks to Chair Mr. Puneet Mishra, Chair of IEEE Bangalore Section and Chair-elect of APMTT Bangalore Section, for his ever encouraging support in organizing all this sort of webinar. And I would now request KTPIA, who is the treasurer of our chapter, to formally introduce the author, to speaker, introduce the speaker, and then we'll hand over the virtual platform to the speaker. KTPIA, please.
Good evening, everyone. I'm very happy to introduce Dr. Ashutosh Kedar, today's lecturer. So, Dr. Ashutosh Kedar received his PhD in Electronic Science in Microwave Electronics, MSc in Physics and BSc in Physics degree from University of Delhi, India. He joined as a scientist in Electronics and Radar Development Establishment, DRDO, Bangalore in 2003. Presently, he is leading research and development activities for active phased-array antennas for various radar applications. He has contributed towards design and development of antenna arrays, and RF and microwave systems for various AESA radars. His interests include computational electromagnetics, evolutionary optimization techniques, and wide scanning active phased-array antennas. He has authored more than 55 research papers in different peer-reviewed national and international journals and conferences, and has a patent to his credit. He received DRDO Technology Group Awards in 2010 and 2018 for indigenous development of single and four-walled active phased-array radar. He is also contributing as reviewer towards reputed journals or conferences under IEEE, YD, IET, UCAP, INCAP, etc. He is senior member IEEE APS and fellow IET, and is honorary Rosalind member of London Journals Press. It is a pleasure to have you with us today, sir. I welcome you to deliver the lecture now. Over to you.
Thank you, KTPIA. Thank you, Chandakant, for giving me an opportunity to share my experiences with the listeners. Good evening to all. It's a pleasure to present this talk, and I'll be looking forward for good suggestions from the listeners, which can also help me in my day-to-day activities. So, keeping the time in the consideration, I'll start now. So, my topic for today's talk is phased-array antennas, system engineering perspectives. Now, the outline of the talk will be, as we're talking a little about the preface, like what is phased arrays, how the system engineering is required to be linked while designing and developing the phased array systems. Then what is system engineering, what are the different methodologies and the ideas to be used, some case studies followed by references and conclusion. So first of all, let's start with the basics. What is an antenna? So antenna is a means for radiating or receiving radio waves. And how does an antenna radiate? We all of us know that from the physics, any accelerated charges radiate. So we can see any time varying current will be equal to the accelerated charges, and that this time varying currents produce electromagnetic radiation governed by the Maxwell's equation postulated by the J.C. Maxwell. Now, what is a phased array? A phased array is a group of radiating elements in which the relative phases of the respective signals feeding the individual antenna elements are varied in such a way that the affected beam formed by the array is reinforced in a certain direction. As you can see in this figure on the right side, we have a group of phased arrays, and in between the two elements, there's a progressive phase shift being given to set the element beam in particular direction. You can see the element beam is getting reinforced in a particular direction. Now, the advantages of this phased arrays are, we have limitations of the mechanical scanning. In any mechanical scanning array, the positioning of the beam is relatively slow because of the inertia of the rotary systems. We have servo motor systems or mechanically manually moving the system to steer the beam towards particular direction, but all these will be inhibited by the inertia of the rotation mechanism. So it increases your reaction times to the targets, it introduces some mechanical error which can lead to some beam pointing error. So the advantage of phased array antennas, first of all, it's done electronically, the rotation of the beam. So instantaneously you can position the beam, you can rapidly detect, confirm and track the targets. The reaction time is quite rapid. We have adaptable data rates, we can control the beam scanning rate. So we are completely eliminate the mechanical errors. We have multi-mode operations, we can form the multiple beams looking the different directions to track multiple targets. We can simultaneously search as well as track capabilities. So we have the capability of controlling all aircraft, cruise missiles, tactical, ballistic missiles, etc. And the last but not the least, it has got graceful degradation. What do we mean by graceful degradation? If out of the phased array systems, if 10% of the elements fail, still my whole system will be working nicely, effectively, giving me the performance. Obviously a compromise. Compromise in the sense, like if you're looking for a gain of, let us say 30 dBi, and if 10% element goes, you may get a gain of somewhere down by 1 dB or 1.5 dB. So that you're, in the terms of radar, the range comes down. Okay. Now the current phased array scenario is, we have different application of phased array systems. So first one is a military radar systems. It could be airborne, it could be ground based or space based. We have non-military systems like Internet of Things, high speed communication, terabit parsec, SATCOM, 5G mobile network, mobile phones or the square kilometer array kind of applications, weather radar, near field communication, anti-collision system, etc. So phased array is a system of systems and it needs a multidisciplinary approach for the design and development. Henceforth, there is a need to adopt some system engineering practices for the design and development of these systems. I hope I'm audible. Okay.
Yeah, you are audible. Only some people are telling it is little feeble, so you can speak a little closer to the mic.
Okay, fine. So now starting with the concepts. But the concepts of system engineering are, system engineering is an interdisciplinary field of engineering and engineering management. It focuses how to design, integrate and manage complex systems over their life cycle. So it gives a system a kind of a thinking principles to organize the body of the knowledge available with us from our past experiences and from the experiences of the other team members or experts. So the individual outcome of this process is an engineered system defined as a combination of the components that work in synergy to collectively perform a useful function. So if you can see here in this figure, so the system engineering mainly consists of three parts. One is called development phasing, which gives you a baseline of the design. Then it comes to a system engineering process, where you have an integrated team effort and come out with some prototype thing. And then you have a life cycle integration, where you're concerned about the maintenance, reliability, and ultimate decommissioning of the system. So system engineering emphasizes upon performance of the whole system, stakeholder needs, like whoever is a user. Suppose in the case of our defense, we have the users like Army, Air Force, Navy, or sometimes like Airport Authority and Coast Guard system. So they are our stakeholder. So we have to take care of the needs, then complete system life cycle, like starting from the conception of the system till the decommissioning of the system, we have to take care how the things will go on. We have to plan everything. Then we have to plans like other design activity, reliability, component testing or requirements. So the major concern of designers is value delivery to the user and other stakeholders through a complete life cycle of the system. When I say user and other stakeholder means, suppose I am a part of a bigger missile program. So that missile program is the user for me, whom I have to give the radar, but missile program is ultimately made for some Army, Air Force, or Defense. So those are the stakeholders. So that is the difference between the user and the stakeholder. So the phases of the system lifecycle can be categorized into three phases. So phase one is the concept development, so which takes care of the stakeholder needs analysis. It takes out the non-functional requirement, which are also called as ELETs in the short form. Generate system architecture alternatives, trade study, and form a baseline solution, and generate a lifecycle plan for the system. So this is a phase one. Now phase two consists of the actual detailed development of the baseline system. So it consists of the engineering design and the prototype development. It consists of the fabrication procedures, manufacturing solution, and the deployment plan. So the result is a viable solution ready for the production. So this phase two gives the system ready for the production level. A phase three consists of production, deployment, operation, maintenance of the system, and eventual decommissioning of the system. This is also very important. How to decommission the system in the end of the life cycle. So system engineering is basically concerned with the whole thing, whole play, rather than the small parts, and it's concerned with the overall system level performance. When a phased array, system engineering concerned with the complete system, its context, its customer use cases, stakeholders, value delivery, reliability, which is very important, and the system performance. So the system engineer who's taking care of these aspects must be involved with the subsystems, and often sometimes the components of the subsystems also, so that he can decide the level of the specification, level of the risk mitigation, technology maturity level, prototype plans and analysis for the alternative for subsystems and components. He can also take care, okay, let us say we are talking about the receiver exciter. He may say, no, no. Nowadays, everybody is going for the digital receiver, etc. I don't need an analog receiver exciter. So there he can interfere as a system engineer. He can say, no, no, I want a digital receiver exciter. But when he's saying he wants a digital receiver exciter, he should know a little bit about that hardware. What are the things required? What are the overall specifications? He should have some idea so that he can get the required thing. So system engineers focus on a big picture, but must also have the ability to analyze details at the subsystem or at component level. So if we consider system engineering in terms of a methodological reductionism, it can be compared to the other engineering branches as a dominant method of scientific investigation. And the goal is to understand the functioning of the parts and to understand the complete system. So see this diagram. So any physical system can be decomposed into smaller parts, and further to the lower level parts, which are subjected to the study. And in turn, they are able to predict, help us to predict the system operation by using the models of the parts, so that the complete overall system design is completed. Blanchard and Fabricy define this process as, first, they say the analysis consists of taking apart what is to be explained, disassembling it, if possible, down to the independent and indivisible parts of which it is composed. And secondly, of explaining the behavior of those parts. And finally, of aggregating these partial explanations into the explanation of the whole. So taking an example, so underlying assumption of this approach is that all observed phenomena explainable using only mechanical cause and effect. So every observed event is a cause of some prior event and the cause. So the operation of everything is considered to be like an operation of a machine. So like if suppose I take example of a TRIA module, so what a system engineer will do, it will divide it into its components like transmit chain, receive chain, control circuit. It will further divide the transmit chain into its constituents, assemblies. Similarly for the receive chain, it will divide into further, and same for the control circuit. So now suppose any problem happens in TRIA module, he can debug up to the lower level, like from where that problem is coming. Now suppose the power output is not as desired, so he'll go down, okay, power output means it is related to a transmit chain. Now transmit chain means it has to be related to the amplifier. So like this he can debug. So this is how the system engineering helps you. Now we have different system engineering approaches how we can process this knowledge into the design and development. So we have first one is a top-down approach, second one is a life cycle approach, and third one is an interdisciplinary approach. We'll discussing all these three approaches briefly. So the first one, the top-down approach, it is concerned with the whole system rather than the parts. And like these authors, Lankard and Fabricy say, it does not deny that the system have parts, but it focuses on the whole of which they are the parts. So it provides another way of viewing a things, a way that is different but compatible with the reductionism. So system is divided into subsystem, and subsystems are further divided into the parts. So the systems are purposeful and developed with the end in the mind, particular to the stakeholder and the user needs. And the engineered systems are understood to be teleological, that is, they are goal seeking, the purposeful ends for the human beings or other objectives. Therefore, the system engineer has to work to maximize the value delivery to the desired function over the entire life cycle. Now, second approach is a life cycle approach, where we are concerned with all the phases from the concept development to the decommissioning. So we check the feasibility, then we go down, we do the analysis, then we do the design, implement the design, we test the design, install it. After installation of the system, then we how to maintain it, we maintain it, we produce it, and we evaluate and ultimately close the approach. The third approach is the interdisciplinary approach. Now, system engineering requires a broad range of knowledge and expertise. So, like if you talk about a radar, so radar should have a knowledge, radar in system engineer should have a knowledge of electronics, he should have a knowledge of mechanical is required, knowledge of material science is required. And so that is how it is an interdisciplinary approach. So if we can see here, the system engineering requires electrical knowledge, chemical, processing, software, management, financial, material, and mechanical. So this requires a balance between often competing interests to transform the customer needs into a system that can deliver value to the stakeholder. So let us consider a modeling approach for the system engineering. So the best modeling approach is a three-phase process, which is dividing the whole modeling approach into three phases. Phase one is the concept development. In the architecture and the concept development, we have the technology opportunities and operational deficiencies as the input. I'll be detailing them in the further slides. Then the phase two is the engineering development. So the output of the phase one is a baseline concept on which we go for the phase two, where we develop the prototype systems, production plan and deployment plan, and then we go to the system production and deployment. So that is a phase three, post development. So in the phase one, in the architecture and concept development, we talk to stakeholders, we determine their needs, analyze those needs. Then we debate on the existing systems. Why can't the stakeholder use the existing system? Why he needs to go for the new system? Why he wants the changes? So we can debate on that, and we can ascertain whether whatever changes he is asking for, whether it is really required or not. So that we debate upon. Then we develop some alternatives to meet the needs of the analysis, and we model those parts. And this forms the baseline design. So input to this phase is the operational deficiency. Operational deficiencies are analysis of the gaps. Gaps means the difference between the whatever capabilities of existing systems are existing and what is the needs of customer, whether the existing specification can satisfy the customer or it does not, or it needs some further capability. So that is the operational deficiency. And technology opportunity. Technology opportunity means something new, such as process, path, component, subsystem, or system that enables new capability, whatever is required. So this architecture and concept development, we can further divide it into, first one, the need analysis, like establish a valid need and the market for the new system. Technically and economically, feasibility is important. Then second is the alternative exploration. So explore the potential system concepts, formulate set of top-level system performance requirements and their validation. Then alternative systems development and analysis. What are the alternatives available with us to meet that thing? Then concepts of operation and the system capabilities generated for all the alternatives. Then third one is trade study and baseline solution. The selection of the most attractive system concepts. Like we have multiple options. We do the trade analysis and see which is the most feasible. which can define our functional characteristics and develop a detailed plan for the stages. And based on that, we form a baseline system concept which balances the capabilities, lifecycle concerns, and the cost. And the fourth one is a new technology validation. So we select the most attractive system concepts, define the functionalities, and develop a detailed plan. We validate all the system level new technology and its applicability to meet the requirements. Then the most important is a risk management plan. That is the most important thing. When you started to design a system, you should identify the possible risk. What is the impact on the system? And how do you manage those risks? So that is very important job for the system engineer. Then the lifecycle plan. Develop a plan that captures the scope of the system from start to eventual decommissioning and disposal of the system. So it will contain all the details incorporated in it through system engineering process. So what is need analysis? As I've already told, determine the stakeholders' interest in the systems and customer must be identified. Like suppose I'm talking about the active phase array, whether it is actually required or a person can go with the mechanical array itself. So that is what we do in the need analysis. Then activity during need analysis, a realistic examination of the existing systems to determine if they can be modified to meet the need with additional functionalities based on the software applications. Like suppose for the drone detection at airport, we require a phaser radar and other system like optical system, IR cameras, etc. So all these technologies are already existing with us. You only need to integrate them to make our drone detection system. Then we have to explore the non-functional system requirements. It is like what is the reliability factor, what is the manufacturability possibilities, and the testability alternatives. So these utilities are very important because in the starting you may feel that okay, they are not required, but with the advent of the lifetime of the system, those things become important. So utilities are the non-functional requirements that capture the user and the customer needs, and their effects are seen with respect to time on the performance. Like gradually, if you don't take care of those utilities, system performance will go down fast. That is very important for us, especially for us radar designers, as we are faced. Now, what is the alternative exploration? So we have two main concepts. One is the system concepts. Okay, we have phase array. So what are the phase array system concepts? Then set of system performance requirements, like you've seen this figure. So we have an active electronically scanned array enabled fighter aircraft. Now it needs to communicate with the satellite. It needs to do search and tracking. It needs to do the GMTI functions, it needs to track the weapons, guide the weapons, and needs to communicate to the land-based and sea-based system. So these are the multiple system performance requirements. We need to capture all of these system requirements. Then what are the system concepts? It's a potential to meet the customer needs. So now we have two methods to do that. First one is the ideation with the subject matter experts. So a matter of generating, developing, and communicating ideas, where idea is understood as a basic element of the thought that can be either visual, concrete, or abstract. Second method is TRIZ, Theory of Inventive Problem Solving, which was given by G. Altshuler. It uses a pattern of problems and the solutions instead of the ad hoc methods and can be used as a framework for trade studies. So ultimately what we are doing, we are generating the system architecture options. So the system concepts, basically they partition the whole system to major subsystems. They generate the alternatives to replace one or more subsystem with more advanced and less costly versions. Vary the chosen subsystems singly or in combination. Consider the modified architecture, whether it is acceptable or not. And continue unless we have four or six alternatives, out of which we can do some trade analysis. So the B, what is a set of system performance requirements? It often occurs during the alternative development. Like one way is the requirement elicitation. We use various techniques to obtain the requirement from the users and stakeholders. See, it is always advised, you have to avoid the direct jump to the functional requirements early itself in the development phase. You should not directly jump to the functional requirements. So you should have complete elicitation discussion with the users and the stakeholders, and then only you should generate the functional requirements on which the system needs to be developed. So like it has been quoted from Karpina and Nishal, that a prematurely translating the perceived stakeholder needs into design requirements is often a consequence of insufficient regard to the end user priorities. So better is you use ELITs as a part of requirements, which can be later used in the baseline selection. I'll be elaborating on this further in my coming slides. So the requirements can be characterized in the three types. One is the functional requirements, then we have quality requirements, and then we have constraints requirements on the system. What are the constraints? You have to analyze those things. So two other methods which can be used for capturing requirements are the system context and the concepts of operation. Can be useful in developing the requirements. Next is the concept of operations. Concept of operations are the statements and the diagrams that describe how the system will be used. So it often includes illustrations or the end state the system can achieve. So using this system context and the concept of operation, we can capture the complete system needs. So the two outputs from this step is a top level system performance requirement and a set of 4 to 6 system alternatives. So now trait studies and the baseline selection. So baseline system is a selected based on the trait study ranking the various alternatives against the weighted system needs. System level modeling is an important part of this steps, ranking the alternatives. So one of the methodology to do that is model based engineering, which uses models to represent different elements of the system, and an engineer can model the performance against the user needs and or relatives to provide data for trait studies. So ways to model is, first one is spreadsheets. Like for my case, like I will tell you, when we start the radar design, we first of all capture the requirements on the spreadsheet, do the basic RF budget analysis and capture the needs. Otherwise, nowadays we have some commercial solvers also, like System View and the Virtual System Simulator from AWR. We can use these softwares also to do that modeling. And the last one, which most of us are quite frequently doing, is we made our own customized software in MATLAB, which can model various things like grading lobe analysis, scan performance analysis, array factor, etc. So this is called as model-based engineering. So the method for using ELITs for selecting a baseline system is called as a quality function deployment matrix, QFD matrix. So I'm not going much detail of the QFD. I'll just give you a glimpse, and because we don't have that much time to do that. So now if you see the slide, this is a QFD, and I have got four options with me. Let us say first option is a two-dimensional scanning array at X band. Okay. Second option is a one-dimensional scanning array at X band, which is a low cost short range radar. Option 3 is a one-dimensional element scanning, which is a subarray scanning, use of subarrays. And we have option 4, in which there is no element steering, only scanning, steering is at the level of the subarray. So we have 4 options. Now our keys are 5 means high, 3 means medium, and 1 means low. So if you come to the criteria first one of ELITs, we have taken 5 ELITs: reliability, quality, reliability, size, and weight. And option 1, 2, 3, 4, we give our keys. So if we say for option 1, okay, reliability is quite high, for example, and if you go for quality, quality is very low, but if you go to other options, quality is very high. Okay, now if you see size, okay, size is good, competent. Other one, size is little bit bigger. Okay, now if you see by weight, option 4 is the best in terms of weight. Okay, so like this we can do some trade analysis. So now if we come for the weighting, so let us say in terms of reliability, weighting is 2, 2, 3, 3, 1, that is 11. So how are this 11 is coming? Value of option 1, we have given value 5, 1, 5, 5, 1. The score is 10, 2 into 5 is 10. So 10, 2, 15, 15, 1, so it is 43. Similarly, for option 2, it is 33, 3 is 33, 25. So if you see out of this, the maximum weighting is for the option 1. So based on this, we can, QFD matrix, we can select option 1 as the baseline solution. This is one of the example. It's not like a thumb rule. So this depends on your survey, your whatever methods I've told you right now, ideation, trails. Based on that, you generate this keys, generate this QFD matrix, and see, okay, you have to go for which option. This is one of the example. So now based on this score, I've already told how to calculate. So we calculate the score, and whichever score is highest, we go for that as a baseline solution. Now comes a new technology validation. So as a risk reduction activity, it is sometimes necessary to validate new and promising technology during the concept development stage. If that technology offers a particular significant edge on the features or capabilities that are important to user and customers. So like for an example, and here I'm telling in my case study also, nowadays we are talking about the gallium nitride technology in the design and development of TR modules. But till now we were working about the gallium arsenide earlier we were working with gallium arsenide technologies and the LDMOS technology came. So you can see that gradually based on the requirements for the higher power, higher ranges of the radar, higher efficiency to reduce the DC and the heat load, we are moving, changing the technology from gallium arsenide to gallium nitride. So this is a new technology validation which we are doing. So the validation of the new technology will often be in the form of an engineering proof of concept. We have to make some proof of concept to prove our technology. We have to generate or make some prototypes, develop those prototypes and evaluate them. Or we have to do detailed engineering studies. Obviously, certainly once it is achieved, a working demonstration form of an hardware or software is available, which can be used for doing the risk analysis for using this technology. Now, what could be the risk analysis on using a new technology? Now, suppose you're using a gallium nitride technology, but if that technology is not available to you in India, it is in banned by US, there are some bans imposed because of some reason, it is not available, then that technology becomes useless for you. So that is a risk which you cannot mitigate. So these all things you need to take care initially before choosing a particular technology. So the risk management plan is, as shown over here, a risk is an event that may or may not occur at some point in time with the possibility of a real loss. Okay. So now, if you see this, we choose particular risk as a candidate for study. We check, okay, whether is it uncertain? No, then it's an issue. We have to study that. If it is uncertain, then we have to go and check whether it is any loss is possible or not. If loss is not possible, then no impact. If it is possible, then we have to see the time component present, means whether the twist comes, how long it exists, when it comes. So, or does it resolve with time? Like suppose a vendor says, okay, I can give you an item in 1 month, but it takes more time. Let us say now I say, no, I can give you only in 6 months. So, but in 6 months, it is going to be resolved. If it is not, then it is irresolvable. And if it can be resolved, okay. It is a risk, but it is manageable. So that is how we qualify a risk. So this is a risk management plan. So first one is you identify and qualify the risk. You analyze the risk. You prioritize the risk. You take steps how to respond to the risk. And that's last you say how to manage that risk. So this is a complete risk management cycle which you need to follow. So other concept development activities which may be used, first one is a life cycle plan development, then assigning the resource management plan and detailed program plans, etc. So now we come to the phase two. Now phase two means we have a baseline solution. We have to go for the prototype development. So that is the engineering development. So this involves actual development of a prototype of the baseline system that can be transitioned into the production. And the principal objectives are to perform the engineering development of a prototype system, satisfying the requirements of a performance, reliability, maintainability, and safety. To engineer the system for economical production and use, and to demonstrate its operational suitability. Finally, to generate the documentation required for the system production, testing, and qualification. So a system engineer, it guides the engineering process with the responsibilities that fall into three categories. First one is definition and management of the system interfaces. That is the details of the subsystems developed. Like if you're talking about a radar, so radar has got different subsystems, like it has got antenna, it has got transmitter receiver module, then it has got exciter receiver, Then after that, it has got a sister RDP, signal processing. Then we have got DC systems, we have cooling systems. So all those are the things for which the subsystems criteria needs to be developed. Then we have to develop the test plan for the each subsystem and for the whole systems to ensure the performance. Then discrepancies in the system performance and the specifications must be resolved in this phase itself. So as the subsystems are integrated and system testing begin, there are inevitable trade-offs and even reallocation of system budgets that may be required. So like if we talk about a phased array, so what are the typical engineering activities for a phased array? Now this is your phased array block diagram, typical block diagram, where we have an antenna, we have a Lona's amplifier, then we have some phase shifters here, then we have beamforming algorithm, then we have detection mechanism and the display. So the typical engineering activities for the phased arrays are, first one is the antenna development, okay, then the IC development, then the TIA module development, thermal design and the heat transfer development. Because of the TIA module, there will be a lot of heat generated, so you need to take away that heat, plan that heat, effect of that heat management plan has to be established. Then we have a beamformer development, then we have a digital receiver exciter development, we have a mechanical structure which will be housing the all the subsystems, then the production plan development, then acceptance and testing, and finally, which is also very important, is reliability, supplier management deployment plan, and the program management. So these are the typical activities captured for the design and development and production and deployment of a phased array. So now the phase three is, once your engineering prototype is ready, everything is qualified, tested, reliability, everything is checked, then we go for the production, deployment, operation, system maintenance, and eventual decommissioning of the system. So now let us, we have learned about the system engineering basic concepts. I hope I am clear. So now let us use these concepts in the phased array concept development. So as I've already told, what are the operational deficiencies? They are the needs experienced by the user and the other system stakeholders that has to be discovered. Then the discovery of the needs can also be a speculative endeavor. Like, for example, if you talk about the Steve Jobs, Apple co-founder, he was able to see the customer needs, that they need smartphones and other smart devices. So they come up with the idea, and today we all of us are using those things. An entrepreneur uses their prior knowledge and the information distributed in the society for opportunity needs discovery. Means a good entrepreneur will study the society, we'll study what are the needs. Okay, this thing is missing. If this comes, society may be helped in a much better way in terms of the medical facilities, in terms of the communication. So he will study those things and see, he'll find out, okay, what is the opportunity? He'll discover that opportunity and invest into that opportunity. So regardless of the source of the needs, new system development starts the needs assessment, which feeds into the concept development. So one approach to need assessment is to focus on what are called gaps. Gaps are the difference between the current and the desired results. So for example, I have a firefighter radar system, which is excellent in detecting and tracking an artillery. But unfortunately, nowadays, drones are the bigger problem. Nobody is directly attacking you or leaving missiles or firing missiles at you. So, but my radar is not capable of tracking and detecting drones. So that becomes a gap. So that gap I need to analyze, assess, and fill it up with the new technologies and come up with a better system. This is called as gap analysis. So what are the technology opportunities? New ideas, products, material, manufacturing processes, and integration approaches. Technology innovation is required for the corporate growth and wealth creation in nations. Technology opportunities are other input to the concept development. And one way to expand on this framework is to use big data methods, data analysis, what nowadays people are called as data science, to extract the information from the existing patents and other sources. And the possible benefit for this approach is a more economical method for discovering of technology opportunities. So you can see this diagram where I try to summarize all these things. So based on this, now we come up with a system architecture. So this is an important step in the development of a baseline concept, because it sets many important aspects of the solution and guides the future development. So according to IEEE, an architecture is defined as an organizational structure of a system or a component. If you talk about from the ISO international standard point of view, it is defined as a fundamental organization of a system embodied in its components, their relationships to each other and to the environment. So architecting is a process of structuring the components of the system, the interrelationship and the evolution over time. So you can see, if we have a logical architecture model, it takes input from the system requirements and decides a physical architectural model. So this physical architecture model is related to the technologies, taking into account the non-functional requirements, utilities. This is independent from the technology. You can model any architecture irrespective of the technology existing. And this is also independent from the solution alternatives. It just defines the requirements. It does not see how the person is going to fulfill the requirements. Anyway, this slide is too crowded, so but I'll like to tell you what I'm trying to do here is, here we are doing to we are designing a system architecture using ELITs. In short form, I call it as PSI. So PSI is classified into six major steps. So first step is the determine value proposition and constraints. So this includes the value proposition, constraints, identification, classification of stakeholder values, and design space preference. Then the next one is to identify potential perturbations. Now, what could be the type of perturbations? Shift, disturbance, disruption, design, context of operation needs, then space, origin, intention, natural, artificial, or natural causes. Consequence could be positive, negative, unknown, or effect. So basically, you have to identify what could be the potential perturbations which could create hurdle in the development of the system. Then we identify initial desired utilities, that we make a preparation of the list of utilities and do some brainstorming. Then based on that, we generate functional alternatives to meet the utilities. We divide the subsystem into its functions for multiple options. We create architectural alternatives. We generate the options for the hardware, software, algorithms, operations. We do the brainstorming with the development team and the stakeholders. Then we generate the architecture options. So we develop number of architecture options as a product of the number of functional. And after that, we select the best architecture option and we. So, and based on this, we develop a QFD matrix. This QFD matrix is generated to do the analysis. Okay, so now let us come to the detailed development activities. Now this is a typical phase array system architecture over here. So we start with a red dome. So this is a red dome which is covering the antenna elements over here. Then we have a antenna structure which consists of the array, like it could be a one dimensional array, it could be two dimensional array. Then we have a TR modules and control electronics, DC-DC systems. Then we have beamformer portion. Then we have the signal processor, radar computer and display, and the beam string control unit, AC-DC converters, transformers, and the main power supply in all of them. So the activities required, I'll just go back. I forgot one thing. So ultimate aim for this architecture is to generate a phase array system architecture which can form the desired beam, okay, which can form the desired beam, which could be steerable. And another thing is to develop the relevant subsystems which could fit into the mechanical form factor as desired. That is also one of the very important thing, that mechanical form factor should be meeting the requirement of a platform. Now what do I mean by platform is, suppose I need to make a radar for a ship. So I cannot make a very big radar which cannot fit on the ship. So I have to take care of that also. If it is for airborne, it's even more constrained. If it is for ground fixed installation, then no tension. We can make it a very big radar. So all these things need to be taken care of by the system engineer. So So what could be the activities required is to study the antenna element technologies, to study the TI models, design and development, to study the thermal design, reliability and heat transfer technologies, to study the array beamforming and the receiver, etc. So when we talk about the antenna development methodology, so how can we create a flowchart of the process? So we have to select the initial design parameters. We have to analyze the alternatives and choose the baseline. We have to generate a 3D EM structural model. We have to simulate and optimize the design parameters. We have to design, build and prototype based on the updated design parameters, compare and validate results, meet the requirements. If requirements are not met, then we continue with the current baseline and we again go here and start the process. If it meets, okay, then it is done. We directly go for the development. Now, what are the, when you talk about this generate 3D EM structural model, what does it include of? You have to first of all come to the array configuration based on whatever the your requirements, like for an array, the requirements are to gain and directivity is specified. The beamwidth is specified. What is the side lobe level required? That is specified. What are the co and the cross pole characteristics? So you have to take care of these characteristics and come up with the array configuration. Then you have to choose a particular antenna element. Now, how do you choose a particular antenna element? It based on what is the bandwidth requirement, whether a particular element can give you that kind of bandwidth, a wide half power beamwidth, like what is a 3 dB, minus 3 dB beamwidth. That basically decides the angular resolution of the radar, so it is important, and obviously low cross polarization. After that, once we have chosen the array configuration and chosen the antenna element, we go to the analysis and optimization of the antenna and the antenna array. Now, when we are analyzing an antenna array, we have to first of all do it in isolated environment. Isolated environment means that we are neglecting the effect of the mutual coupling and the finite edges of the array boundary. Then we have to analyze in the array environment. We will take care of the mutual coupling effect. How does it change the antenna performance? And accordingly, take care of that thing. Further, where we are going to mount the system, whether it is a ship, whether it's an aircraft, or whether it's a tank. So those platforms you have to take, put your array on that platform and analyze the performance. That is called as platform sighting and interference. So the array configuration will depend on the directivity and the range of radar, which will decide the size and the number of elements in the array. The half power beamwidth is proportional to the array size, so that will decide the resolution of the radar. Then scan zone of the radar, whether you want the radar to scan 120 degree or 90 degree or 45 degree, that will decide the inter-element spacing and the array lattice. So these are the three main parameters for the array configuration. What could be the array configuration? Now, as I've already told you, that the radar range is proportional to the gain of array, which is proportional to the array size, and in fact, it is proportional to the total number of elements in the array. Now, the half power beamwidth is proportional to the aperture size and the amplitude distribution, and the scan zone is proportional to the inter-element spacing. Now, see this formula. So gain is typically equal to 4 pi times the area of the aperture divided by lambda square. So, the gain is depending on the frequency, and it depending on the aperture. So whenever you're designing a system or array, depending on whatever the gain require, you can choose the frequency of the operation, and you can, after that, you can choose the area. Now, suppose you want, let us say for a 30 dB gain, you need some area of, in terms of lambda, of around 20 lambda by 20 lambda. But now 20 lambda by 20 lambda, if you talk about the L band, how much it will be? It will be 20 lambda into typically 300 at 1 gigahertz. So that means 6,000. But such a big array, you cannot fit on an aircraft. So if you go for an X band, where the wavelength is only 30, so it reduces how much? 1 by 10 times of that. So that much size will come down. So accordingly, you will choose the frequency. After choosing the frequency, then you can decide the area. Okay, I need 20 lambda by 20 lambda area at X. And that area will give you the desired half power beam. Now, the next concept is the scan zone. Now, scan zone means this is my visible region, the green portion shown here. And this is my beam, black one. Now, if this beam scans to this direction or any direction, after up to this point, it can scan properly. But after this, this other beams start coming into this region. And these are called as grating lobes. And these grating lobes are not desirable because they create a false alarm. If a grating lobe is existing in the scan zone or visible zone, what we call for an antenna, my radar will be seeing the target from two beams. And I will not be able to ascertain which one is true and which one is false. So that is why we always call it as aliasing, and we have to avoid this aliasing, the grating lobes. So this resides my inter-element spacing. So typically my inter-element spacing should be less than half lambda. Okay. Now these are the different grid options. So like I can go for a rectangular grid with a circular aperture, so that at the end I can reduce some number of elements, and this will also help me naturally reducing the side lobe level. Then I can go for a multi-faceted rectangular grid array. It's a kind of a conformal array, or I can go for a hexagonal grid like this one triangle. We can make this hexagonal grid. In this also I can reduce 13% element that compared to the normal rectangular grid, or I can go for a subarray configuration. So these are the various options which we can choose. Now when I want to choose the antenna element, so I've got different options of choosing the antenna element. So I've categorized the elements into different types. One is the wire antenna, then we have got a traveling wave antenna, then I've got microstrip antenna, I've got log periodic antenna, I've got aperture antennas, then I've got other antennas. So in wire antennas, we have short dipole antennas, dipoles, monopoles, etc. And I'm talking about the traveling wave, I've got helical antenna, Yagi Uda antenna, spiral antenna. Then in reflector antennas, I've got corner reflector, parabolic reflectors, like kind of a dish antenna which is shown here. We have microstrip antenna, which is a very good antenna for lightweight systems, and where we need to make the system in high production volume, because microstrip antenna is a printed technology and we can do mass production very easily. It's a lightweight, but only problem is the power handling. It cannot handle very high powers. Then we have LPDA, log periodic antenna, which can give us ultra wideband bandwidth. So for ultra wideband application, we can use these type of antennas. Then we have aperture antennas like of the horn antenna. Horn antenna is the most basic and very popular antenna element. We have Vivaldi's also. Then other antenna means near field communication antennas and the Fractal antenna. So this Fractal antenna is very good for the mobile handsets type of applications. So this is a criteria, how can we can choose the antenna. So just briefly talking, like we can choose the element, we can study the element in the isolated environment, then we can do the mutual coupling and the finite ground plane study on the element. So if we see here, this is when we are not considering the platform effect. When we are putting a platform, this truck is in which I place the antenna on this portion. This antenna beam gets affected. If you see here, so this is my beam and this is my side lobe level, but when I'm putting this on the truck, there's a little bit distortion in the beam and a little bit increase in the side lobe level, as you can see here. You can see this increase in the side lobe level, and this is a non-symmetry as compared to this one. So this is the, so these effects need to be studied a priori before finalizing the system. Now coming to the next subsystem, that is the transmit receive module. The transmit receive module consists of a transmitter and a receiver with the common leg architecture. This common leg consists of a phase shifter and TR switch and a variable gain amplifier. So basically attenuator, phase shifter and the TR switch. So TR switch shifts between the TX and the RX chain. So when the array is transmitting, it goes to this side and transmits the power. When it's receiving, then a switch comes to this side and it receives the power. So this side we have receiver consists of an LNA, and this side we have transmitter consisting of the power amplifier. Now, what is the design flow of a TI module is, we generate a golden schematic, okay? Then we do some design trade-offs and optimization. We do the design review and sign off. But before that, we also, this is an analysis part, but before that we also, while implementation, we do the layout generation. Now based on my design, when I generate a particular layout, I subject to the parasitic and the EM and electromagnetic analysis. And this electromagnetic analysis, if I found some problems, then I go back to the schematic and change my schematic. If it clears, then I go to the next step, which is the design verification. In the design verification, I generate the netlist, I finalize the bill of material, and then I finally go for the manufacturing. So this is a complete design cycle of a TI module. So what are the different design parameters of TI module is? First one is a noise figure. So noise figure takes care of the all the gain blocks, all the gain chains, and it decides the overall noise figure of TI module, what is required. Then we see the 1 dB compression point and the 3 dB intercept point, which decides the harmonics and the saturation power level of the TI module. Then, as I earlier told, that we decide the technology, whether you want to go for the gallium arsenide, whether you want to go for the indium phosphide, whether you want to go for the gallium nitride, silicon germanium or silicon CMOS. So I give a little bit comparison in terms of the gain performance, noise figure, P1 dB and IP3. So gallium arsenide, it is excellent in terms of the gain performance, it's excellent in terms of noise figure, and P1 dB and IP3 points are okay, well enough. Indium phosphide also is comparable to gallium arsenide. And when you come to the gallium nitride, you see that the P1 dB and IP3 is excellent. That means you can achieve really higher power levels as compared to the gallium arsenide here. Okay. But in silicon germanium, these are acceptable. That means silicon germanium can be used for the low power application, not for very high power applications. Similarly for the silicon CMOS. So this is how we choose the technology, which technology needs to be used for realizing the TI module. And this is a limiter thing, so which limiter we should go for? We should go for reflecting limiter or absorptive limiter, like, okay. Then we decide the power added efficiency, like whatever amplifier you are design you are doing, what is the power added efficiency you are able to achieve, then what are the circulator, what are the PSHs, all this. So this is how we design the TI module. We check the various design parameters on basis of that. What are the subsystem of a TI module? Because this TI module itself is a system, small system. It consists of the amplifier, low noise amplifier, limiter, circulator, phase shifter, attenuator, and so on. So we need to design all that. So this is a typical example of an X-band radar gallium arsenide MMS chipset taken from a book by IJ Bell. So where you can see how he has chosen the different technologies for designing this thing. So if you see this 6-bit phase shifter, he has taken from MACOM. Then he has taken the switch also from MACOM. Then he has chosen this LNA limiter with 2.5 dB noise trigger and 10 watt CW integrated limiter. And hyper amplifier he has chosen, which is giving a 10 watts of power with 10 volts driving power. And it's a driving. So like this, based on this composition, he has decided, okay, what is the maximum operating frequency? Okay, if I go for silicon BJT, I can go up to C band. If I go for LDMOS, I can go up to S band. But if I go for GaN, I can go up to X band. So this is how we can choose the technology. Then operating voltages, okay. If I go for GaN, I can go for very high operating voltages, 50 to 65, which is quite lucrative. Gain, very high gain, 12.5. Efficiency, very high, 53%. Pulse width, 1 millisecond. I can go for very high pulse width. Duty cycle and go to CW. So if you see how the gain is compared here, okay. So based on this desired specification of a TI module, I can choose a technology. But suppose if I don't want to go for these kind of thing and I want to go for low power or something reasonable thing, moderate thing, I can go for BJT and LDMOS technology as well. Because if I go for gallium nitride, obviously the cost will increase. Now if I don't want my system to be expensive and I can compromise for the lower performance, then I need not go for telemetry. So that is what I need by the need analysis and the stakeholder discussions and the technology evaluation, all those things. The other technical challenges in the realization of a TI model could be, first one is the heat transfer. Sometimes the heat flux is several thousands watts per centimeter square. So if you're seeing this diagram, you can see this is an antenna, and these are the RF feed throughs, then these are the TI models, small chipsets of the TI model. You can see the form factor over here is very compact, and they are packaged very compactly, okay? So this packaging will lead to the localization of the heat, and that heat needs to be taken away. So how to take it away? So we have a lower cold plates here, through which we pass on the liquid and which takes away the heat. So this is cooling technology. Then we have to take care of the signal integrity, because there are a lot of electrical signals flowing in a very compact manner. So they will be coupling to each other. So I need to take care of that. Then when I'm indicating this complete box, complete this thing, I need to take care of the various integration aspects. Then what are the different layers, material, that materials need to be compatible with each other. So I have to see whether I have to go for LTCC, HTCC, and so on. Then obviously electromagnetic compatibility and multi-layer technology, how to realize the technology. So these are the different technical challenges which a system engineer has to take care, consider them before finalizing the specs. Now this is the array forming application. So once your system is designed and all at the front level, that is the antenna and the TI model, next is how to do the beam scanning. Now electronically the beam has to scan and form a particular plane wave front at that particular angle. So to give some kind of a complex weights here to these elements, so that there's a beam is getting formed along this direction. This is the function of the array beam formers. So nowadays we can do it digitally. So we have a FPGA based, we can make a coding in FPGA. With the use of the FPGA, we can generate some different data sets of the weight as shown here. And those different data sets of weight can be supplied to the array, and we can form different multiple beams simultaneously. This is also called as digital beam forming. Okay. So nowadays we have digital receiver exciters. So we don't no more using analog receiver exciters. So we can do the beam forming at the subarray level, like as shown in this figure. This is another aspect of technology which needs to be studied by the beam forming, and obviously it's that needs analysis of FPGAs, modems, data converters, ADCs, then amplifiers, filters, mixers, and all those things. So you can see how complicated the system is, and how much important is the need for a system engineer and the system engineering principles. So let us go for a case study. So let us take a antenna designed by me, active phase designed by me. So we need an active phase system which is having a high power aperture product. That's the operating C band. Gain should be more than 30 dBi. Scan volume should be 90 degree and 360 degree in azimuth. Peak side of level should be less than 30 dB, not dBi. This is wrong, sorry. So only minus 30 dB. It needs a guard and shall be an electronically scannable. So these are the broad specification of the system required. So the solution proposes, we design an antenna aperture of 400 lambda square, and with the power output of 25 watt at each port, and we make a four wall array like this. One, two, three, four. So this gives me the 360 degree, and each wall is able to scan 90 degree. Then intervening spacing is chosen 0.6 lambda to give me the scan of plus minus 50 degree. Then I choose a hexagonal array lattice so that my elements gets reduced by 40%. And I have used a gallium nitride based semiconductor technology because this is the only technology in C-band which can give me the power output more than 25 watts. So based on this, I come up with an architectural function block diagram. So anyway, this is a typical block diagram. This is antenna elements, then this is a TR module. Then we have got DC-DC supplies, sub-barriers, beamform, etc. Already I have experienced, I won't dwell much time on this thing. And another design cycle, I design an element design in an isolated environment as shown here. So I design some patch element backed by a cavity, which operates in the band. It takes care of the operating band, takes care of the desired beamwidth and cross polarization. And I do this element design in the array environment, where I take care, consider an 8x8 or 11x11 array environment. And I see, okay, in this array environment, how much band I'm getting, how much beamwidth I'm getting, what is the cross pole, and what is the mutual coupling estimate. Because this is a unit cell shown here. So this unit cell basically assumes that it's an infinite array, and this infinite array will only ignore the edge, like finite edge, as shown over here. This finite edges will be ignored, but it will take care of the coupling aspect of these two elements. So if I'm suppose considering this element, so how this element performance is affected by nearby element, then how it is affected by this element, then how it is affected by this element, all this effect, which we call as a mutual coupling effect, can be estimated on this element's performance. Now after doing this, we come to the array design. We see what is the beamwidth, what is the resolution, what is the peak side lobe level, and then finally, platform analysis. So this is my aperture, external aperture. This is my grating lobe coverage. So you can see this grating, this completely free of the grating lobe. There is no grating lobe entering in this zone. Okay, so I get my desired scan zone. And this is my element, which I designed, and this is my return loss. So I am able to get my desired band. This is the radiation pattern, so I'm able to get the desired beamwidth. Okay, so it's an air field, basically cavity, cavity back patch. This is a cavity, this is a patch. Okay. This is the study of this patch in the array environment. You can see these ripples. These ripples are basically happening because of the mutual coupling from the nearby elements, and you can see a little bit increase in the side lobes also. Now then after this, I simulate the full antenna array, and this is the element array performance. So I get the beamwidth, I get the necessary side lobe of 30 dB. These are the major performances. You can see the major return loss. There's a mutual coupling estimate. So you can see as we go, the mutual coupling reduces. And this is my return loss in the array environment, and this is in the isolated environment. This is the effect of the platform. So you can see there's a non-uniformity because of the platform. And there's a little bit widening in the beam also. C-band was designed using a gallium nitride technology to get the power greater than 25 watts. This is a design shown for the C-band. So I packed the 4 TR modules in the one which we call as a quad TR module. And I chosen the power output per port or receive gain in noise figure gain better than 20 dB, noise figure around better than 4 dB, and switching time and rise fall time for the pulse. What is the rise time? What is the fall time? And what is this pulse? Pulse loop means, so this is the pulse loop. How much is this variation? This is the pulse loop. Then I use some 7-bit phase shifter and 7-bit attenuator efficiency of the overall system, and RMS and attenuation in the phaser. So this is how I designed the TR module. These are the typical simulation curves. So this one is studying the P1 dB. This is studying the harmonic level. And this is done using Keysight ADS. So like this, we have AWR also. You can use any of the system which you're familiar with and do all this analysis. And I did the complete phased array simulation using system view, and I studied the performance. You can see here the red and the blue one. What is the difference between the isolated case and the arranged MM case? So the mutual coupling thing is taken care here. Then I did the pattern characterization in the presence of errors. Now, apart from the effect of the mutual coupling, there are a few other parameters, like whatever attenuator and phase shifter I'm considering, they are not ideal, okay? So they have got some variations because of some material properties or some digitalization property. Now you see, ideally your phase should be like this, okay? But because of this, if I suppose I choose a 6-bit phase shifter, so my phase will be given like this. So this is these steps. They introduce a something called as quantization error. So these errors need to be taken care because they will deviate the phase from the actual phase required. So we study the variation of the phases with the different attenuation states. Like for a 6-bit, there will be a 64 states. So I need to study the variation over the 64 states. I need to study the, for each phase value, there will be some kind of attenuation also. So that is this attenuation. And also the variation of the phase with the frequency. So all these parameters I have to study. Similarly, I have to take care of the non-ideality of the digital phase shifter also, in addition to attenuator. So here again, I have to consider all these effects with the different states of the phase shifter with respect to frequency. Now, if you see here, I consider the effect of the quantization. So this slide, it shows the effect of different bits. So two bits, 3 bits, 4, 5, and 6 bits. So you can see this average beam pointing error, how it is varying with the number of bits. So this one is for 2 bits. So you can see that the beam pointing error is quite high. But as we increase the bits, the beam pointing error is going down. And for the 6 bits, the beam pointing error is less than 0.5 dB, which is highly desirable. So from this graph, I can make a decision, okay, I need minimum 4 bits. I have to restrict my phase shifter beam pointing error in this range. Okay, so I need to go minimum for 4 bits. I cannot afford to go less than 4 bits. Now you see the effect of the bits, number of bits on the array factor. So you can see here how much variation is there in the side lobe level, especially the far side lobe levels. Here it is not much of variation, but in the far side lobe level, you can see the variation. So this is for 3 bits and this is for 6 bits. So there is somewhere around 12 to 24, somewhere around 12 dB variation, which is very high. So this is again a system analysis, part of system analysis, that how many number of bits of phase shifters and attenuators are required. But there's another effect, like I told you, because of the quantization of these steps are introduced. Okay. Now, these steps will, what they will do? They will, suppose I need a phase of 4 degrees and I choose a 3-bit phase shifter. A 3-bit phase shifter will not be able to give me the 4-degree phase shift. I have to go for a 6-bit because the minimum resolution of the 6-bit is 5.625. So this is the only thing which can give me the resolution. But still, the 6-bit also will round off this value, and instead of 4, I will get somewhere around 6 degrees. So there is some kind of error introduced. So this error, you can see here, it comes in the form of this parasitic side lobes level, like this. You see this blue one, this is a parasitic side lobe level. Now, these are not desirable. So I have to do, I have to choose some algorithm to suppress these things. So how can I do that? I can distribute the quantization errors throughout the phase shifters. Means I am possibly introducing some kind of a delta factor, which is spread through the phase shifters to counter this errors. Means if one value is going high, other value should go down, so that it compensates to some nominal level. So we can choose, there are different methods. What method I have chosen is from the Shen and Zhao. So you can see here, the red one is with this algorithm implemented. So I can reduce the parasitic side loads. So this is called as a rounding off of the quantization error, and this is implemented in the array, otherwise you will not get the desired performance. So these are typical results which we can measure in our chambers, which we call as a near field test range. And then near field test range, we get this kind of beam. So this beam, what information does it give to us? It gives us the information about the directivity, what is the beam width, what is the side lobe level, what is the average and RMS side lobe level, and what is the beam setting error or beam bending error. So this is the final step where we are validating our prototype. That is a phase two engineering development. So once this prototype is established, we can go for the phase three, that is a production plan. So anyway, with this I'd like to conclude my presentation. And so what I've tried to explain today is I've tried to explain the phase array design and development in terms of the system engineering principles. I've discussed what are the various system engineering basics, methodologies and modeling approaches discussed, how from the system engineering perspective we can explain a phase array development, and finally I've given a case study of the phase array in details to you. And these are few of the references, like one of the references Hanson, which is a very good book on the phase array antennas. And there's a very good system engineering books by Sturdivant. Then there's a one good paper on the recent advances in GaN HAMM development. There's a recent paper published in IEEE Radar for my case study, what I've published here. So if anybody needs more detail, they can refer to this paper. Then these two papers are very good for mitigating the quantization errors. And apart from that, there are many other references in IEEE on system engineering concepts and phase array development, which people can, if they're interested, they can go on. So with this, I'd like to conclude my presentation. Thank you all. And I'm open for the question forum. I think I've finished quite well in time. So we can have a lot of questions in those sessions.
Yeah, Dr. Ashutosh, thank you for your nice presentations. Actually, I was wondering what are the things that you are taking care in while designing your systems.
Yeah.
It's a, means it's a really big job. I don't know how, means how to take care of all these things with a single person at the helm of that.
You need to have a good team. Okay. It's a team effort.
So that is another aspect, that one good team is always required for this one.
Yeah, good team is always required. And just a system engineer.
Yeah, and that's what I was telling, that system engineering approach, that starting from the customer, means the stakeholder, as you are saying, that what they want, they should understand what they want. They should not have something fancy and cause the system like havoc. And so it starts from there, and you started from there, and then you came to the technical aspects of the thing. And in the meantime, I request all the participants to put their questions in the question and answer window. There are a few, quite a few questions in the chat window too. I'll take up them one by one. And then you came to the actual technology level, and then you came to the case studies where you have demonstrated what are the things that you are doing and what are the performance parameters and all, how to optimize the quantization and so what and what not. There are a lot of things to tell. So first of all, one person is asking, then can dielectric resonators can be used for space application?
From my radar point of view, we can use dielectric resonator antenna. But as far as I assume, I think, yeah, for higher frequencies we can use, because the dielectric puck size will go down. But from the reliability point of view, personally, I don't favor dielectric resonator antennas from the reliability point of view. Because how to hold that dielectric puck with some adhesive, and when it is subjected to the extreme temperatures, will it be still holding or not? I am quite suspicious about that. So personally, I will not prefer dielectric resonator antenna for space applications. But you can also give your views.
Yeah, you have hit the right point, that mechanical aspects of electrical performances and all these things are very good. But when we realize the system, mechanical aspects are more, even means that is the first driving point when you're designing something, whether it can be mechanically stable, whether it can withstand the launch load or variation load of track movement, all these things. So there only the dielectric antenna is losing the race, I feel. So we hope to see some new technology coming up to take care of this mechanical aspects of the dielectric resonance antenna. And there is one more, this one. In L band, is the antenna becomes too complex? What compromise we need to do if we reduce the number of array elements?
No, I don't say that L band it becomes complex. What I wanted to imply is L band the array size becomes too large. So like if for some specification, like usually we go for L band when you go for a very long tracking radars with a very longer ranges, but for the ground based systems where I'm not restricted by the space of deploying my radar. So there I go for L band, but L band is very good because in L band I can get very high powers. I can go up to the power of around 600 watts per element, which is not possible at higher bands of frequency. But unfortunately, if I'm going for an airborne application or space zone application, L band does not suit me because the size becomes too big. So I will not say it is a complex. I will say it is very bulky and large size.
Yeah.
So that is the reason we use it preferably for the land-based applications.
There is another question. This frequency of operation of the radar, is it chosen? What is the procedure to choose that one? Is there any coordination agency, or you can choose your own frequency, or
so
something?
The frequency of the radar is basically, sometimes it is suggested by the user also. But more generally, we only decide the frequency of the operation based on the operational region of the radar. Like typically, if I go for an airborne application, I prefer the frequency X band and above because the size becomes less. And like I told initially itself, I need a 20 lambda by 20 lambda aperture, which in X band is only 600 mm by 600 mm. But if you go for L band, it becomes somewhere around 6 meters by 6 meters. So we only see, okay, like suppose somebody asks, okay, this is a range required, this is a power required, this is a resolution required. Then we ask him, what is the platform where you're going to mount the radar? If you say it's a ground base, first of all, I'll straight away go for L or S band.
Mm-hmm.
But if you say no, it is for some moving vehicle, like I showed my C band case, that is for a vehicle mounted radar which will be always moving. So there I cannot go for L or L band. I will go for S or C band. But in S band, I cannot get that kind of range because my size becomes more, so I go for C band. Similarly, if I go for a missile application or a airborne or set application like a fighter craft, nose cone of the fighter craft, I'll go for X band. So this is how we choose the frequency typically.
But just I have one query on the respect to this one. What is the highest frequency band we have developed the operational radar?
KU band.
Frequency, maybe? Range?
Around frequency, exactly, I cannot tell.
No, around.
Yeah, so I can only tell the KU band.
Okay.
Yeah.
And then another question is, while radar is very important, it shows HPA comes at the end. So we need to have many HPA paths interfacing antenna array.
Yeah. I didn't get your question. What is the question?
Actually, what he is asking that we are putting HPAs at the antenna ports, no? Close
yeah.
to antenna ports. So
yeah.
It is not a single amplifier. It is multiple distributed amplifier. So that's what he
correct,
is.
Correct.
So there will be many interfaces with the antennas. That's what he is asking.
Yeah, that is the complexity we handle in terms of TR modules, in terms of beamformers. That is the complexity what we are handling over there, and that is what I was calling that heat transfer, thermal study, all those things takes care of those complexities only because of the multiple amplifier distributed. But at the same time, this distribution of multiple amplifiers reduces the overall power. Like in the olden days, we need a single transmitter of 1 megawatt or so. Now that 1 megawatt of power is distributing at the level of the element, which is just hardly 20 watts or 25 watts. So that way it is advantageous also. And another thing is I called, explained is a graceful degradation. So if like suppose out of 100 my 10 models go bad, also still 90 will be working, my radar will be on. So this is the advantage of this distribution.
Okay.
Am I able to satisfy or no?
Yeah, I think it will be. That means you are distributing the system, so you can reliability increases and your power requirement from a single module also comes down. And your total high power capacity of the total systems also remains relatively small. It need not to handle 1 megawatt power in throughout the chain.
Correct.
That is some other advantage as well as thermal management on the chain. So next decision is. Okay. Another this question. Well, radar is very important. These days, the subject is removed from ECE syllabus. Your comment, please.
That I need to talk to the teacher only why they removed it. Because for us, microwave engineers, radar is a very important subject.
Another question is how they are asking. How we estimate the array aperture size? That's what he wanted a little elaborate.
I think that I explained in one of my slides. I'll come to that.
Yeah, that's what he is requesting.
It's here.
Can you clean the slide? Or
yeah,
not
I don't know how to clean.
Okay.
I don't know how to make it dirty. No, I'll do it.
No, no problem. You carry on. Maybe it will take some time.
Okay. So, clear all pointers. Yeah. So, you can see here. This area aperture of the antenna array is directly determining the gain. So if you see this relation, the radar range is directly proportional to the gain of the array and it's proportional to the aperture size. So whatever the gain or range of the radar is required, that decides the aperture. And another thing is beamwidth. What is the resolution of the radar I want? That will decide my beamwidth and that again will decide my aperture size. So basically aperture size is determined based on the range and the resolution requirements of the radar.
Okay. Okay, that should be fine. And there are some compliments also that your presentation is very nice. All these things I'm not reading, I'm skipping them.
I need more critics so that I can improve the presentation. But anyway, thanks for the compliment.
Yeah, I think you should split this presentation into two, maybe. That's what my suggestion. It's a lot of material.
Yeah. Yeah,
how much tolerance is accepted in simulated and experimental results in phased array antenna design?
Usually, we take care of the tolerance. We always design with a 10% margin only. So that practically, if the system goes on, it still meets my specs.
Okay.
So we kind of little bit over design the system.
How
like
suppose
10% is okay. 10% is okay. Like suppose I need a beamwidth of 1 degree. So 10% of that I can tolerate. I can go up to 1.1 or 0.9 like that. And if a gain is let us say 30 dB, so I can go for 29.5 to 30.5 dB, something like that. So plus minus 10% is okay.
Then I was just wondering if you need a 1 degree beamwidth, so what do you target? 0.9 or 1.1?
Sorry?
If you need a beamwidth of 1 degree for the layman, say who is starting the design, so he'll start which way? He should start at with a 0.9 as a target design or 1.1?
Yeah, preferably I start with 0.9 only.
Because in practice, you want to say that it
better better the angular resolution. It's more helpful to me.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, means if it is a narrower, then it is not of less problem. If it is broader, it is bigger problem.
Broader, it's a bit problem, yeah.
Okay. So we should always target the negative, means in minus side of the tolerance.
Yeah.
And next one is how to measure the noise figure, the array.
Noise figure of array we don't measure. Basically, we do it by the system tools. So like for the different blocks of the array, like TR module and array scan loss and all those we measure separately. And like I shown that system engineering tool of the system view. So we put all those figures in that blocks and then we measure the overall noise figure from the these tools only.
Mm-hmm.
Practically we cannot measure.
Okay.
Yeah.
I have a general question here. Somebody has asked whether there are some labs that can support some of the external design. You can suggest some of the labs, maybe outside your or some industry, they are doing this sort of HMC fabrication or something like that.
Yeah, yeah. Lot of there are there.
Any link or something? Means some of the people. Can you suggest?
Yeah, I can share that. They can send me a mail. You can send me a mail. I'll send you the links. You can distribute it.
Okay. Somebody has asked whether if you can throw some light on the antenna on the Rafale, something special, something. If you have any idea.
I actually don't have any idea of the antenna about the Rafale, which one they're using. But as far as I know, it is not a phased array. It is,
okay.
I think, passive phase array, something like slot-based technology. I'm not sure.
Mm-hmm. So I'll take up the last questions. There are many technology that take up GaN and gas, all these things. So,
yeah.
And as it looks like GaN is the best one. So what is the maturity level of GaN addition in India?
Now GaN is quite matured in India also. In India, in fact, our DRDO foundries and lot of Indian industries are there who can realize GaN modules within the country itself. And in fact, in our project, we have
foundry,
used the
foundry is also there.
Foundry is not there.
Okay.
Foundry is not there. Only we have the PDKs from those foundries. We can do the design, everything, and get those things developed from those foundries abroad.
Mm-hmm.
I think your ISRO himself, they have used our GETEC foundry.
Yeah, that's when. What is the maturity level? Is it used in your radar somewhere or something?
Yeah, we are using it. We are using those devices. Yeah.
What is the efficiency you will be getting?
Typically, if you talk about the gallium nitride device,
mm-hmm.
at the device level, we can get efficiency better than 45%.
Mm-hmm.
As compared to gallium arsenide, gallium arsenide efficiency is somewhere around 25 to 30%.
Okay.
And overall system level, from gallium arsenide to gallium nitride, efficiency advantage is only 5 to 6%. But the biggest advantage what we get is, like suppose I was talking about the C band. In C band, if I go for gallium arsenide, I can maximum get 10 watts of power. Wherever from the gallium nitride today, I can get 100 watts of power in C band. So this is the huge difference which tempt us to go for the gallium nitride technology, although it is a costly technology compared to gas. Like if a gas is a 10,000 rupees device, gallium nitride devices is somewhere around 40,000, four times. So okay. That is why I told that active phase array is a luxury which should be only used when you can afford it or you really can't do without it.
Mm-hmm. That's why your system engineering come into place, so we should understand the requirement and we should understand why they require this particular thing.
Yeah, whether we really require or
not. Because they will be asking for all the fancy things and they may not be knowing the repercussion of that one on the system.
Yeah, so we have to counter the user also, why he needs that actually, whether he really requires it or not.
Yeah, so that is the first aspect of system engineering, I think, that I could take over from this one.
Yeah.
So with this, for the want of time, there are a few more questions. I'll not take those things. And I scrolled through them and they're already answered in your presentation.
Okay.
With this, we come to the conclusion of this particular nice talk.
Yeah.
I thank the speaker, Dr. Ashutosh, for taking a lot of effort. I know I am pursuing this one with last couple of months, and he told he is preparing the slides, so it is he has taken a lot of pain in preparing the slides. And it's a nice thought, means from it's a total engineering, I'll say. It's not only the design of the hardware or some component or something like that. Starting from that, how to go to the next level, how to integrate and how to manage the engineering and manage the design, all these things. It's a complete engineering. That's what I was suggesting, that it should be maybe 2 hours or two or three sessions on this talk can be made easily out of this. So thank you very much for your all effort.
My pleasure.
And
thanks for giving me an opportunity.
So we'll have more closer interaction. Hopefully we'll have physical meetings soon when we resume, and that will give very good vision grasp, and the people also will able to comprehend more vision, because who is not in the field exactly, they may be having little vision about following some of the things. So people, when you are physically in contact with the speakers, so that we hope that it is coming soon.
Maybe COVID gets over soon.
Then that's right. Another 6 months I am expecting. And on the other side, I thank APMTT chapter chair, Santil Kumar, chapter chair elect Puneet. And Puneet is also the chair of Bangalore section for helping us in organizing such a webinar. And Kirti Priya, she is always there supporting these activities. Today, she is not able to propose the vote of thanks because of some connectivity issue. So I thank her also for her continuous support. Any activity, she is there, and any activity, Puneet is always ready to support us. So with this, I conclude this session, and I wish everybody a good night. And thank you, Ashutosh, Dr. Ashutosh, once again. Thank you very much for your time and effort. We are closing the session.